miniaturized LiDAR scanning unit specifically designed for vessel-mounted survey applications. It is supported by drivers in all major hydrographic survey packages. This video shows the unboxing of a system and all the components and accessories contained within the transit case. The transit case itself is a Pelly case rated to IP67 when closed, and the complete system in the box weighs around 45 kilograms. Make sure the kit is securely packed away in the transit case whenever it is stored and/or shipped. This is the Merlin itself. It weighs around 12.5 kilograms without the mount and stands around 42 centimeters in height. The laser rotates against the main housing or pod, and this is mounted between two A-frame pillars that sit on a base plate. The structure is designed to make mounting the system on a vessel very simple, straightforward, and flexible. This is the actual laser. We are firing an infrared laser 36 times per second. The laser is sent from the transmit optics, and after hitting the target, it is received back through the receive optics here. Merlin uses time of flight techniques to then calculate the range to an accuracy of around plus or minus 1 centimeter. Maximum distance that the Merlin can range to is about 250 meters. As the laser is firing, it rotates like this at a rate of up to 20 tons per second. The speed is controlled through whichever software you're using. An encoder is measuring the rotation angle to an accuracy of 0.01 degrees. While the platform on which the Merlin is mounted is static, this will give you a vertical 2D circle of points. However, on a moving platform, combined with feeds of position, attitude, and heading, a 3D point cloud of the environment can be built up. On top of the unit is a GNSS antenna. This is not designed to provide the position of the system, but it will allow the Merlin to receive timing information. Timing is sent to the laser, ensuring that all the range and bearing information can be time tagged. This is essential if data from the Merlin is to be combined with data from other systems. This data from sensors such as IMUs, positioning systems, and multi-beam echo sounders will also be time tagged, thus enabling the hydrographic survey software to match up the relevant data and produce a correctly geo-referenced point cloud. At the rear of the Merlin pod is the connector which takes in the main umbilical cable, which carries power and data to the pod. This is protected by a cap when not in use. The physical orientation of the Merlin pod can be altered vertically and horizontally. There are fixed angle stops of 0, 15, 30, and 45 degrees. Use the vertical locking stud to secure the unit in place. Changing the vertical angle away from horizontal can give better results when scanning vertical objects such as lampposts or pillars, as it will ensure that more rotations of the laser will hit the object at different heights. When you change the vertical angle of the Merlin, you can also adjust the GNSS antenna to ensure that you have the optimum sky view to see satellites. The Merlin mount also allows the unit to be rotated horizontally after it has been fixed in place on the vessel. Again, changing the angle which the laser is looking relative to the vessel can produce better data in certain situations. The base plate comprises a rotating upper plate and a lower plate, which will be secured to a fixed mount. Two horizontal locking studs allow the upper base plate to be fixed at angles of 15, 30, and 45 degrees either side of the central 0 degrees orientation. The Merlin will usually be mounted so that 0 degrees will be pointing parallel to the vessel's center line. We supply a flange plate which is designed to be fixed solidly to a suitable location on the vessel. It may be welded or bolted to the vessel infrastructure. The Merlin can then be bolted down on top of the flange plate. With the flange plate in a permanent location on the vessel, the Merlin can be easily mobilized and demobilized to the exact same location without having to remeasure and recalibrate each time it is reinstalled. A center line provides a reference for the orientation of the Merlin system, and usually the system will be fixed in place so that it runs parallel to the vessel's center line. The cross at the center is the measurement datum point. When measuring lever arms, XYZ offsets from the IMU, or COG, will be measured to this point. The interface box provides a stable voltage supply to the Merlin system, as well as acting as an interface for the system cables. Typically, the interface box will be installed inside the cabin, although it is rated at IP66, so can withstand being externally mounted if required. The interface box weighs around 2.7 kilograms, and its footprint is about 22 centimeters by 23 centimeters. There are mounting locations on the base. It can be mounted in the vessel either horizontally or vertically. This is the heat sink, which helps to dissipate heat. Be aware, when mounting the interface box, there should be enough space left around this area to allow airflow to help prevent the unit from overheating. As this is the front panel, again when mounting, take account of the fact that you will need good access to this side of the box, as this is where all the cables are interfaced, and you will need to ensure at least 40 centimeters of space for cables to bend and run into the appropriate connector. Going through each item on the front here in turn. For the laser data to be useful, it needs to be time-stamped. The timing source button allows you to select where the timing information originates. Press the button to scroll through the options which will be indicated by the LEDs. If all three LEDs are off, the Merlin is using its own GNSS receiver to produce its own time tags. When the EXT LED is illuminated, time tagged information is being fed into the system from an external source. In this case, you will need to connect this external source up to the ZDA port. This is where you will receive an NMEA time string and also the PPS port. This is where you receive the time pulse, which identifies exactly at which point the ZDA information should be applied. So that if you are using external timing information, if we are using the internal GNSS device on the Merlin to timestamp the laser data, we can also export that timing to other sensors on the vessel. In this case, we set LED 1 or LED 2 to be illuminated, indicating that the Merlin, which is connected to Merlin port 1 or Merlin port 2, is sending out this information. Again, the ZDA and PPS cables should be connected to allow the connection with the third-party sensors. There are two parts for the main umbilical, as it is possible to run two Merlins simultaneously on a vessel through one interface box. Having two Merlins mounted at different angles can produce complementary data and ensure that optimum coverage is achieved with a single pass. An Ethernet cable connects the Merlin system to a PC running Merlin diagnostic software or a hydrographic survey package. That cable will be connected to this port. The USB port here is purely for diagnostic and troubleshooting purposes, and you should not need to use this unless under supervision by Carlson support personnel. The power button turns the Merlin on and off when a power cable and an umbilical cable are connected. The power state LED indicates initially when power is being supplied to the interface box, followed by indication of power and communication being supplied to the Merlin unit. Just beneath the power button, there are three status LEDs which indicate system faults. The voltage LED indicates a fault with a voltage supply to the interface box. Voltage will have risen above 30 volts DC or below 11 volts DC. The current LED indicates too much current, so more than 18 amps is being drawn. The temp LED indicates if the box is too hot, which means greater than 50 degrees centigrade, or too cold, less than 10 degrees centigrade. Finally, here is the power connector to which you connect a DC power source. We will review the power options shortly. So that is the interface box. Now to go through the cables which connect to the front plate. First of all, the main umbilical cable. This cable is 12 meters in length and has a male and female military style connector on each end. The umbilical cable provides communication, timing, and power between the Merlin unit and the interface box. It's a very tough cable as it will have to run externally across the vessel from the Merlin to the interface box. This connects to the back of the Merlin and then to the Merlin 1 socket or the Merlin 2 socket if the second Merlin is being run from the interface box. This is the USB cable. Again, it is only to be used by trained personnel for performing diagnostics on the system, so you don't need this for normal operations. The Ethernet cable is 2 meters long with a standard Ethernet connector to connect to the PC and a SARU connector to connect to the interface box. The ZDA cable is 2 meters in length, again with a SARU connector to attach to the interface box, and then a 9-pin D-type serial connector to interface to the external device, which is sending ZDA timing messages to the Merlin or receiving them from the Merlin. The PPS cable is 2 meter in length. This carries the timing pulse to or from the Merlin. There is a threaded RF TNC plug on one end, which connects to the interface box, and a BNC bayonet connector on the other end to connect to the external sensor. This is a low voltage power cable to be used if you are running the Merlin directly from a DC battery or other low voltage DC power source. 2 meters in length, a SARU connector on one end to connect to the interface box. The other end has a ring crimp connectors which connect to the DC power source of 11 to 30 volts. Black and red connectors to negative and positive terminals respectively. The alternative to the low voltage power cable is the mains power supply unit, or PSU. You can plug this into a mains power supply of 100 to 240 volts AC, and this will convert the power to DC. If you're using this PSU, then the low voltage cable is not required. This unit is not IP rated, so out of all the equipment, this is the only element which must be mounted inside a dry location. 4 AC cables are supplied to convert the power supply unit, or PSU, to the mains power supplies in different regions of the world. Another cable connects the power supply unit, or PSU, to the interface box. A metal male SARU connector attaches to the PSU, the female SARU connector to the interface box. There are a number of different ways of connecting the system together depending on whether you're using one or two Merlins, an internal or external timing source, and the low voltage cable or the mains PSU. I'm going to connect the system together now. In this case, we just have one Merlin system and we'll be assuming we are using the internal GNSS receiver for the timing. Also, I'll be plugging the system into the PSU and running from the mains power supply. So first of all, the umbilical can connect into the back of the Merlin. Like most of the connectors used with the Merlin, they contain a keyway, so you need to rotate the connector until a positive fit is found. Push the interfaces together, then twist the connector end clockwise until a firm lock is obtained. You will hear a click. And now to the interface box. It connects into the female Merlin 1 socket on the interface box. We are going to take power from the mains power supply, so we'll need to use the power supply unit, or PSU. I'll start by connecting this to the mains power supply, and then connect the PSU to the interface box. Again, turn the connector until you hear a click, and you will now know it's securely fastened. On supplying power to the interface box, the power state LED will illuminate red, as you can see. This indicates that power is being supplied to the interface box, but we are not yet powering the Merlin itself. So I can now power the Merlin on. After pushing the power button, the power state LED flashes green. When the LED is solidly green, communications are active and the Merlin is ready to go. So I can now connect the Ethernet cable to the interface box. And then to my PC. My PC is running the Merlin Diagnostic software. I can use this software to configure the Merlin and to test and troubleshoot the system. So here I will turn the laser on and start it running. When using the Merlin for actual survey operations, you connect up the system in the same manner, but you will then be interfacing to a hydrographic survey software package, taking in a variety of different sensors in addition to the Merlin. The last item in the box is the USB stick, which contains the diagnostic software and the main operator manual. Also included are manuals which take you step by step through using the Merlin with a number of the most popular hydrographic packages in the market. We have produced a separate video to go through the PC software operation.